Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome to tonight's performance at the Royal College of Music. I'm Amos Miller, I'm the head of brass here, and during this interval we shall be talking about some of those thrilling performances we just heard in the first half, with some of those involved, and also what we're about to hear in the second half, Mussorgsky's Pictures at an Exhibition. As you've already seen, we are joined tonight by the legendary trumpet player and conductor Håkan Hardenberger. It's great to see so much brass featured in this concert, and we'll be joined this interval by two of our soloists and our leader. If you're an up-and-coming brass player and would like to know more about studying brass and life at the Royal College of Music, do scan the QR code that should be appearing on your screen now. And you can also follow our Instagram page, which is at @RCM_AmosMiller for more kind of live updates of what we're all up to. I'm here with our two trumpet soloists and our leader from the Symphony Orchestra concert this evening, Euan Scott, who's played the Folke Rabe concerto, Josh, who's playing the Turnage double trumpet concerto, and Joel Monday, who's our leader. Josh, so you've just been working on and playing this week the Turnage Dispelling the Fears double trumpet concerto. I just wondered what your feelings were about getting into the nitty-gritty with on stage with a soloist of Håkan's calibre.
It's the most exciting thing in my career so far. I mean, he's absolutely huge. He's been a role model for me for many, many years. Ever since I remember, to be honest, playing, he's always been like the guy that I go to in terms of like trying to imitate the sound of a trumpeter. He's the one that I try and play along with. So having the chance to play alongside him in a concerto is just the most exciting experience for me, and I'm absolutely honoured to be able to have this opportunity to do this.
Great. No, I mean, it's a really exciting project. So when Mark Anthony Turnage spoke about this piece, he described the two solo parts being conceived for a single instrument with two distinctive personalities, and that there's a physical and visceral quality to the music. Is it harder to play than a classical concerto, for example, or is it just different?
I think it's different in a way, because in classical music you're trying to create this beautiful sound and this proper like natural like trumpet sound, whereas in contemporary music, in this one specifically, because you're creating this, it's a much rougher sound, a much harsher idea, because you're creating this different sound world, and so you need to, it's completely different skills that you use to create this world, as opposed to playing classical music, which I enjoy the challenge. It's any chance to play sort of different music, any different sounds come up with like different skills needed for it.
Extended techniques.
I love the whole like use of all these techniques, so I'm excited to play these.
Great. We're also here with Euan Scott, who's performing the solo trumpet concerto called Sardinsarkofagen by Folke Rabe, a Swedish composer, which was obviously written for Håkan, and he's made it famous. As a performer, obviously you will have listened to Håkan's recording of this piece. How has that informed the way you've practiced it?
Well, I looked at the piece at first, tried to get my own sort of idea of it, and went through it, and then obviously, you know, listened to Håkan's recording of it, and, you know, take inspiration from that. I mean, obviously, he knows what he's doing.
Kind of.
Yeah. So, yeah, trying to take as much inspiration from that as possible, and, you know, take inspired ideas, not completely copy it, because it's own performance and it's its own thing, but obviously, yeah, I don't think he can do much wrong when it comes to it.
So, before we leave our trumpets, just a question for you. In April this year, we've got our first ever Royal College of Music Youth Brass, RCM Youth Brass Ensemble. We're working over a weekend with some of the current students as mentors, and we're attracting young brass players from across the music hubs around London. And we're going to put together a concert which will be in this beautiful hall, and will also be part of our sort of brass prize final as well. I'm just thinking how important those opportunities are for young musicians and young brass players, and what kind of things allowed you to kind of see yourself at an institution like this when you were younger?
Well, I mean, I think it's hugely important to give people this opportunity. Music's such an exciting world to be a part of, and a great skill to have, because it's something that anyone from anywhere can get involved with, and it's its own language that you can learn, and it's beautiful to do. I came through brass band background, and the local brass band we had used to go around schools, do sort of like open brass days where you can go and try the instruments, and if you really enjoy it, they had tons of instruments to lend out to you, and you can go join their training band. And my teacher, who was a conductor of the band, he's the first guy to sort of like get me up and involved with the trumpet, and sort of, or I started on cornet, and got me through the training band. And I think without that brass band there to give me the instrument that I had, and to helped me through my journey in brass bands, I don't think I'd be here today. So I think it's massively important.
Those relationships are really key, aren't they? And also playing with your peers, it's a sort of different environment than a sports pitch, perhaps. But was it similar for you, Euan? You come back through the brass band?
I came up through brass bands, but I also went to like RCS Juniors and Douglas Academy Music School up in Scotland. And, you know, it's great to have these experiences and surround yourself with people that, you know, you could be spending the rest of your, if you want to do it, career with. And even if you don't want to do it, there's, you know, all these skills that cross over, you know, like teamwork and, you know, just making music together and enjoying things together.
Definitely, and sort of multitasking. I think sometimes as musicians we underestimate how much multitasking we're actually doing because it's something we've been doing since we were really young. Yeah. Thank you very much both. So turning now to our fantastic leader for tonight's concert, Joel Monday, who's a second year master's violin student with us. Thank you for joining us.
Pleasure.
Obviously, we've all grown up listening to Pictures. It's an absolutely major sort of chestnut of the repertoire. What's different about actually playing in the orchestra for it, especially, and what's different about leading it for you?
It's a really special experience playing this with the RCM Symphony. This piece is played by everyone, and to play it in with young musicians gives a really fresh interpretation of this piece and brings something, I think, new to Mussorgsky's masterpiece.
It is a masterpiece, isn't it? It really is. And obviously the orchestration is by Ravel, which I was wondering, the relationship between art and music is obviously central to this thing, and I wondered how you felt that Ravel's orchestration added on to Mussorgsky's amazing composition brings those paintings to life in different ways.
Right. I mean, I think Ravel, he's famous for his incredible way with colours. You know, his orchestration is phenomenal, and he really brings that to this piece, and that's why his arrangement is so special, because obviously there's countless arrangements of this piece. I think Henry Wood wrote one, and when he heard Ravel's, he actually denied any performances of it. So yeah, I think Ravel really brings a lot of beautiful colours to this piece, which you can imagine was in Mussorgsky's mind when he was writing it for a pianist.
What are the challenges for you as physically as a string player and also as the leader in sort of pacing yourself through that?
Yeah, I mean, I think through the whole piece, there are many different challenges from a string point of view. Also to really remember the balance of this piece, that there is so much amazing writing for the brass and woodwind, but also we have many wonderful moments, many fiddly moments. And actually at the end, it's just really, there is a great sense of liberation in the string section.
Because it's we all can going also, into one and you can kind of sing. And,
yeah, we also can really give everything in that last moment and just enjoy building up to that Great Gate of Kiev.
Cool, so just that wraps things up for our discussion. Thanks so much to these fantastically inspiring young players. Joel Monday, our leader, Euan Scott and Joshua Cusworth are our two trumpet soloists from this evening. We've got a special treat for the second half of this interval. Earlier in the evening at the RCM, we heard a special performance by RCM piano player Paul Natsakhanov of the original version of Mussorgsky's Pictures at an exhibition for solo piano. And earlier this week, we caught up with Paul in our newly unveiled fabulous state-of-the-art performance simulator, which is an adaptive acoustic space which can be preset to pretty much any concert hall sound in the world. If you'd like to find out more about our state-of-the-art performance simulator, you can scan the QR code that should be appearing on your screen now, and see you in the second half.
Hello, I'm Paul Natsakhanov, and I've just been playing the piano version of Mussorgsky's Pictures at an exhibition. It's a very interesting idea. The composer, Mussorgsky, who is walking through an art gallery of the artworks of his deceased friend, Hartmann. At the very beginning, you have the promenade as well. Throughout the piece, you have these moments called the promenade, which is an autoportrait of Mussorgsky himself. And it changes. It changes based on the artwork or drawing that he sees. If at the beginning it's quite, you know, joyous, then further on it becomes more reflective or it becomes a bit more grandiose. My favorite part of the cycle is Baba Yaga and the Great Gate of Kiev. Baba Yaga is a Russian witch very evil, very spooky. And what is interesting about this picture is actually the drawing which has survived and from which Mussorgsky draws his inspiration for this piece. It's not actually of Baba Yaga, it's of her house. And in the middle section of the Baba Yaga, you can actually hear, you know, this sort of awkward movement of the house, because it's a creature, this house. And it has a clock, and so you can hear this sort of clock, which is not exactly on time, sort of maybe half broken. And that goes into the Great Gate of Kiev. And this one is, I think it is the most special of all of them. It's very monumental, it's very joyous, very open, and it's been a huge project working on this cycle, but it's something that I think is a real event, having learned the cycle and performing it.
Thank you.